Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We've no apologies this morning, and today we're continuing our Stage 1 evidence taking on the Police Ethics, Conduct and Scrutiny Scotland Bill. So I invite any members to declare any interests before we get underway. Would you
like to declare interest? Yes, I suppose I should. I have spoken with both witnesses in the past, in my previous job as a journalist, and I think also while as an MSP in respect of the first witness, some of her clients.
Thank you very much. So I welcome Margaret Gribben to the meeting. Margaret is attending online. So thank you very much for taking the time to attend our meeting this morning. We really do appreciate it. And I refer members to papers 1 to 3. So I intend to allow around 45 minutes for this evidence session. And I thought it might be helpful if I opened up with a question for you, Margaret, just about the police complaints system. So I wonder if you can just outline what you think should be changed about the police complaints system based on your own experience.
Yes, good morning, Convener and Committee. First of all, I'd like to extend my thanks to you for giving me the opportunity of sharing with the Committee the experiences of my police officer clients in relation to police handling of complaints. In the answer to your question, I would say that complaints against police officers of all ranks should be assessed, investigated and determined entirely independent of the police.
Okay, thanks very much. Are you able to just expand a bit on that?
Yes, in relation to my own experiences of the police officers that I have acted for, and indeed recently we just need to look at, it was a batch of independent investigations last year, for example, HMI CS, the IRG report. There's also an internal, I think it was a sex equality and misogyny working group, and they all recognised problems in the police complaint handling procedure. HMI CS, for instance, had said that the misconduct processes were perceived as lacking openness, transparency, and fairness, and the status quo in relation to Police Scotland reporting on them to the SPA Complaints and Conduct Committee provided limited assurances on the standards of integrity, ethics and values. The IRG, the Independent Review Group, in their May report of last year, and they looked at complaints primarily in the context of equality and diversity, which is where my experience lies in relation to the police officers that I have acted for. Because mainly for the police officers that I have acted for, it's what I call your cop-on-cop complaints. I know you've heard evidence last week, and that's mainly been members of the public who are making complaints, and there's a remit there for PERC. For officers in the course of their duty making complaints, mainly for the officers that I have acted for and currently act for, they're making misconduct complaints in relation to whistleblowing and alleged sexism and misogyny against fellow police officers. So they don't have the option of any form of independent scrutiny, perhaps unless they've got the time and resources to take a complaint to an employment tribunal, and that's often a last resort. But they don't have PERT as a resort, so they're pretty much stuck with the Professional Standards Department and the police investigating the police. And what the IRG found, and this is certainly consistent with all of the cases, there's a number of recurring themes in the cases where I act for police officers, but one recurrent theme just seems to be an absolute failure to engage or address issues of misconduct involving discrimination. And that's exactly one of the findings of the IRG report last year, where they found, and also in the context of complaint handling, the Professional Standards Department play an absolutely critical role. They are front and centre in terms of how the case is assessed, how it's investigated, and a role in determining that. So they're absolutely critical in setting the tone. And what IRG found, and it's, as I say, this is consistent with the clients that I've represented, is they were less prepared to address issues of misconduct where it involved discrimination. So I think we're starting from a place where actually we know there are major problems because of what these independent reviews have told us. But also, if you actually look at it was an internal working group of Police Scotland last year, sex equality and misogyny group, and they surveyed, I think it was over like 528, or they surveyed a larger number, but there was like 528 responses. And of the police officers that they surveyed, a staggering 81% agreed that sexism and misogyny was an issue within policing. 86% of female colleagues had either been subjected to or witnessed sexism and misogyny. More than 40% of male colleagues had witnessed sexism and misogyny, and only around half of those surveyed thought Police Scotland was tackling sexism and misogyny. So we know there is an issue. We obviously know there is an issue with cases like Rona Malone, cases like Karen Harper, where we see the consequences of complaints not being handled properly, particularly in the Rona Malone case. That was tragic on so many levels. It was tragic for Rona Malone, who was an experienced and talented firearms officer who had so much to offer to policing, but basically her health was affected to such an extent that she had to retire. But also it was the cost there to the public purse of £1.5 million. And I'm afraid from the cases that I have dealt with and I am currently dealing with on behalf of police officers, nothing that I have seen, unfortunately, has convinced me that there's been any sufficient change since the Rona Malone judgment. And I think that it's inevitable there's going to be another case or cases of that type. And I think the complaints handling procedure is, I think it's crucial to that, because in the Malone case, they just didn't deal with her complaints of sexism and misogyny. And it was bold and it was overt. You know, she had made a complaint that she'd been victimised for raising concerns about a sexist email. PSD told her, yeah, they tried to dissuade her from raising the complaint. And when she wouldn't be dissuaded, they confirmed to her in writing that the complaint would be investigated. It wasn't investigated. It was never investigated.
Okay, thank you, Margaret. I mean, there's a lot in there, but very interesting to hear that overview. I mean, there's quite a lot of things going through my head when you were just setting that out. And one of them, I suppose, was around culture. And I know we're not, you know, that's not what we're here to discuss, is the broader issue about culture in Police Scotland. But, you know, I think from the session that we had last week and what you've outlined so far this morning, that's evident and it's present. Would you like to comment on that?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I mean, you talk about culture, and you know, you know, what does that mean? It's vague. It's an elusive term. But from, I think probably to bring it alive for you, I can just give you some examples. So let's take, and obviously, I've acted for Rona Malone and Karen Harper, and I can discuss those cases because there's two employment tribunal judgments, and what I'm discussing is in the public domain. But I've got three other cases where I'm acting for police officers at the moment, and all of them are in the employment tribunal, or one's about to be put into the employment tribunal. So I can give you just some examples from those cases. Like, take the Rona Malone case. The Karen Harper case, first of all. Now, in the Karen Harper case, she alleged that she was being discriminated against by her sergeant. She lodged the grievance. She alleged sex discrimination in that grievance. Now, what then happened was the sergeant, who was the subject matter of that grievance, then alleged that PC Harper had been guilty of off-duty criminal conduct. So what I see is a weaponization of the complaint handling procedure by PSD and Police Scotland, particularly for those clients that I've represented, the ones who are standing up and whistleblowing and are being courageous and brave enough, you know, to call out sex discrimination. Now, the tribunal found there that, quite simply, that what that those allegations that stemmed from the sergeant against PC Harper, they were just quite simply an act of retaliation. Now, what also happened in the Karen Harper case was they then were investigating Karen Harper. Now, in the course of that investigation, she lived in a small town and everyone knew everyone's business, and PSD knew that she had a divorce. Her husband was an ex-police officer. It was a fairly acrimonious divorce. Now, the complaints that had been made against PC Harper were completely unconnected to her ex-husband. But what happened is PSD officers visited the home of her ex-husband after she'd raised the grievance and invited him to make a complaint against her in the form of a statement. So that's one example of culture. In relation to...
Come in there, Margaret. I think that set out, you know, the issue that we're looking at very well. But just in order that I can bring other members in, if we've got time at the end, I'll maybe ask you to outline some of the other examples that you've mm-hmm. referred to. And just for clarification, when you refer to PSD, I take it that's professional standards of Police Scotland?
Apologies, yes, yeah. Professional standards. And you'll know that, and hopefully we'll talk about it in a bit more detail in relation to Section 5 and 8 of the bill. But you'll know in relation to complaints of misconduct against all officers below ACC rank, it's PSD that have got responsibility, which is the overwhelming majority of police complaints.
That's helpful, just to outline that. OK, I'm just going to open it up to other members, and if anyone would like to come in, then just please Sharon Dowie and John Swinney. Sharon, first of all.
Thank you. Good morning, Margaret. Can I just come back to something that you said earlier on there? You said that there was issues investigated complaints of discrimination, and then you said that they were less prepared. Is the issue because you feel that they don't want to investigate the complaints, or is it a problem with their procedures?
No, I think it's an absolute mentality that they just don't want to. Let me give you the example in the Rona Malone. So in Rona Malone, she had tried to raise a grievance. You know, she was ticking all the boxes, or trying to tick all the boxes. The grievance was, I don't know if you recall the case, but it was a silly sexist email which her sergeant had sent, basically saying, if there's enough male firearms officers on duty, then I don't want to see two female firearms officers out on their own. It was clearly a blatantly discriminated email, even although for years up to the litigation, Police Scotland denied that it was. Then on day one, the tribunal, everybody accepted it was demonstrably a textbook example of an ill-judged and sexist email. So Rona had complained about that email and had believed that the officer dealing with her complaint just had dismissed it and wasn't taking it seriously. So she then tried to raise a grievance about, you know, the mishandling of her complaint in relation to the email. It was clearly a grievance, but professional standards, P&D, HR, professional and development, had said, no, it's not a grievance. And I mean, it clearly was a grievance. The tribunal found it was a grievance. So Rona Lomond then tried to raise the issue with the Professional Standards Department. They tried to dissuade her, because at that point in time she had a tribunal lodge, and said, why don't you deal with it as part of your tribunal mediation? But it had nothing to do with the tribunal. So she was resolute in making it quite clear to them, no, I want you to investigate this. They confirmed to her in writing that they would investigate it. Absolutely nothing was done about that. Now, they're supposed to log all complaints onto their Centurion database, and then an investigation would follow. Now, in Rona Malone's litigation, the highest ranking officer that gave evidence on behalf of Police Scotland, and you may recall she had multiple victimisation claims, which the Employment Tribunal upheld. But the most senior officer was the then head of PSD, a chief superintendent. And he was called upon to explain, look, you know, you've stated in clear and unequivocal terms in an email to this officer that you're going to investigate, but you didn't even record on the database. There was no investigation. Now, the tribunal found that the explanations for the failure to investigate by that, by the PSD and by that chief superintendent were implausible. And in evidence, what he'd said is, oh, you know, I get a lot of emails. You know, don't we all? But, you know, I get a lot of emails and I drop the ball. Now, what I would say, certainly from history in the Rona Malone case and the other cases that I act for, is there was never an intention to pick up the ball. And again, I really can't explain the psyche. I think I saw in one of the reports, I don't know whether it was the Angelini review, that there seemed to be Police Scotland are quite relaxed about holding their hands up and saying, oh yeah, we're completely incompetent, but you know, we don't discriminate. And they do, because it's just, you know, classic examples. And this isn't, none of this is rocket science. And for me, it just seems inexplicable, because when I'm looking at these cases, it actually takes more energy and it takes more time not to deal with it properly than it does for them to basically try and, you know, circumvent and just to you know, dodge the issue. And as I say, the problems that creates, obviously for the officer, but obviously, you know, it just, you know, questions the integrity of policing as well. And there's potential cost ramifications for the public purse when these cases end up in an employment tribunal.
Yeah. So one of the comments you'd put in your evidence, you'd say that Police Scotland, and referring to Rona Malone case, you said that Police Scotland obstructed every phase of the liability litigation. Do you think the bill that we've got before us will do anything to change that attitude, such as statutory code of ethics or a duty to be honest and cooperative with investigations? So do you think the bill, as we've got it just now, will help?
Margaret, before you come in and answer that, I wonder if I can maybe just encourage you to focus some of your answers on the provisions of the bill. I know that it's often hard for people to do that without referring to individual cases, but we've got limited time and other members are looking to come in. So if it's possible for you to do that, that would be appreciated.
Yeah, if I could just quickly address, and I would like to address the committee, because the sections I've looked at more closely is sections 5, 8 and 13. But just to answer the last question, you know, I don't think it's going to make a massive amount of difference in practice. I mean, my understanding is, you know, in terms of the, you know, the oath that all police officers, then that, you know, that should be inherent in what they do in a day-to-day basis. I mean, if it's codified, then I don't suppose it'll do any harm. But I think we need to, in terms of the context of police handling, I don't think the duty of candour and ethics on its own will be enough, I'm afraid. And I've got just concerns about the limitations of some aspects of the proposed legislation, in terms of Section 5, 8 and 13. And if I could share those with the committee. So in relation to Section 5, so the committee will know that what this proposed to do is widen the functions that can be conferred on the PIRC, and that's to be done in secondary legislation, and this is in relation to key areas of senior officers' misconduct procedures, including the statutory preliminary assessment function. Now, anything that's moving towards independent scrutiny, I think, has to be welcomed. But we need to look at who this is actually going to affect. It's only going to affect senior officers. So that is those officers of ACC rank and above. Now, what we're talking about here is about a dozen officers. I think it's 14 or 15. So we have, as far as I understand it, 16,500 full-time equivalent police officers in Scotland. So Section 5 will not affect the overwhelming majority of complaints against the police. So the Angelini review is referred to the most complaints, or the majority of complaints against the police, being against the rank of constable. And I don't know if the committee have got, you know, up to date complaints, how many are dealt with each year, and, you know, how many, you know, emanate from the public, how many from police. But essentially, in relation to the overwhelming majority, 99.9%, if not 100%, the status quo will remain. And what you will have, I think one of your witnesses, Mr. Johnson, you know, referred to it as an in-house investigation. And essentially, that is what it is. So what it will be is the status quo will remain. The vast majority of complaints, it will be the police investigating the police. So whilst any move towards independent scrutiny is welcome, we really need to look at sections 5 and 8 in relation to look who is it covering? And it's covering a tiny, tiny, tiny number of police officers. And I don't know in the last 5 years, you know, what percentage of complaints have been in relation to ACC and above. I imagine it would be tiny. So the vast majority, Section 5 is not going to touch. And if we look at the policy aspirations behind this bill, it's to ensure, as far as I understand it, there are robust, clear and transparent mechanisms in place for investigating allegations of misconduct against the police. And unfortunately, in my view, the legislation will not meet those objectives with such a narrow definition of who Section 5 applies to.
So just a quick question then. You've mentioned a few litigation cases that you're dealing with. Do you think that the litigation could be avoided if the complaint handling system was completely reformed? Do you think that the police complaints handling system needs completely reformed?
Undoubtedly. Undoubtedly, I believe. If complaints were independently assessed, in my view, that would have quite a significant impact in the number of cases going to employment tribunal, or just number of cases of complaints generally.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. And that obviously has resource implications as well, because you don't just have the compensation cause, you have the time and the resources of Police Scotland's in-house solicitors, potentially external private solicitors, and all the legal fees as well. So I just think it makes sense from a public policy perspective. Also, as well, at a time where we are rightly concerned about policing, the public do have concerns. So we know there's a problem in relation to complaint handling, but that this bill, unfortunately, is not addressing that for the vast majority of misconduct complaints against police officers.
Okay, thanks for that, Margaret. Can I bring in John Swinney and then Russell Finlay?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ms. Scriven. I'm interested in your point about the necessity for independence in the process of complaint handling. As I understand it, there's, I suppose,
three areas where complaints may be given some degree of consideration. The first is in the general HR relationships of a serving police officer with the organisation. The second will be with the Professional Standards Department. And then the third is potentially the PIRC. So is the committee to conclude from your experience and caseload that you think under the current arrangements, procedurally and culturally, none of those three elements are working effectively to protect the public interest when it comes to complaints about police officers' conduct?
Okay. Just in relation to PIRC, I have the very limited experience of PIRC, because I'd basically said in relation to the officers that I've acted for, they are not deemed to be members of the public for the purposes of their complaint. So therefore, PIRC don't have an oversight. So largely, it's been in relation to misconduct complaints dealt with under the 2014 Police Service of Scotland conduct regs. That's for ACC and below. Now, usually, and more often than not, where there is a misconduct complaint, that will fall into the remit of PSD rather than HR, which is maybe more of a grievance type complaint. But sometimes there can be an overlap in relation to both. So my experience of professional, what is called in Police Scotland, professional and development, which is HR, is largely in relation to the Rona Malone case, where they just simply refused to deal with her complaint as a grievance. So that clearly was a concern. But in relation to PSD, who I do have a lot more experience of, and that is one of the recurring themes in the cases that I deal with, is the role of PSD. If I give you a stark example, I'm dealing with a case at the moment for a detective inspector, and it's in relation to the inconsistent approach that they say a PSD take. And there is evidence in some of the cases as well that PSD are not handling matters impartially, and they're not handling matters independently. There certainly is evidence, you know, to suggest that there's outside interferences in the decisions that they take. The stark example of that case I'm dealing with at the moment, where my client is alleging inconsistency of treatment. What she is saying is she has called out sexism and misogyny in the area of policing that she works in against both herself and other female officers, and also in police officers' attitudes towards female complainers of sex crimes. So she's made those complaints. She herself is now being the subject of a PSD investigation for what she is saying is trivial misdemeanors and doesn't warrant a PSD investigation. Now, one example that she gave of inconsistency is an officer that she supervises. Now, both she and a sergeant have made complaints that they believe that this officer exhibits sexist and misogynistic conduct. This officer was guilty of off-duty criminal conduct. Now, there's no ambiguities about that. The British Transport Police were involved. It involved a female transport worker who was abused by this intoxicated officer. Most of it was recorded on body cam. And what had happened was PSD, you'll know that there's what's called a preliminary assessment, and they can determine whether a matter falls into category of gross misconduct, or what's called an improvement action, which, if you like, colloquially, you know, a slap in the wrist. You know, improvement action means it's not subject to any investigation. It doesn't go any further. Now, in relation to that, the officer who was basically was guilty of off-duty criminal conduct. The Professional Standards Department determined that only warranted an improvement action. Now, that to me is inexplicable. You have a police officer who's guilty of an off-duty crime, And what this officer did is he abused and he alarmed a female transport worker. Now, this behaviour was consistent with the behaviour that my client, a detective inspector and a female sergeant, were saying about this officer. Now, despite all of that, he was only issued with a with an improvement action. Now, to me, that is just completely inexplicable.
So from that, your point to the committee is that the bill that we have in front of us doesn't actually get close to affecting a real source of difficulty, which is the effectiveness of the professional standards system within Police Scotland. Would that be a fair summary of your position, Ms. Gribben?
Yeah, that's correct, Mr. Swinney, because they're dealing with everything for ACC and ACC and below. And actually, you know, if before I dealt with any of these cases, you would have said to me, you know, what's the most important part of, you know, complaint handling, I would probably have said something like, oh, it's determination. But it actually isn't. Because if you look at preliminary assessment, if the police are deciding, which they did do in this case, that off-duty criminal conduct of an officer doesn't even warrant an investigation, then I think that's pretty serious. And I think that in itself, you know, was enough for alarm bells to ring to say, well, look, you know, we cannot trust these people to impartially assess these complaints at any stage. That has to be subject to independent scrutiny. Now, even if that had gone on to an investigation and then it had gone on to a hearing, there's a range of options that would be open to Police Scotland, ranging from verbal warning, written warning, first written warning, final written warning. But to conclude that it didn't even warrant investigation, that's where I would say that some of these decisions being made by PSD are unsafe. And I have to contrast that with my client's experiences of the conduct procedures being weaponised against them, against whistleblowers and those calling out sexism and misogyny, and the same approach to complaints is not being adopted. That's pretty stark examples of that.
Thank you for that. My last question is really following up your point, which you made to earlier on about the importance of independence in the process. And I just wonder, I know that you said a moment ago that you don't have much experience or engagement with PIRC, but in your concept of independent handling and scrutiny of complaints in relation to the police, would you see PIRC as being a body that could potentially undertake that, or are you suggesting to the committee that we should consider something that is even further removed from the existing structures of policing in Scotland for handling such complaints?
I think ideally further removed, because I've heard the evidence from some of the previous witnesses to the committee about their perceptions of PIRC, in that it is staffed by a lot of ex-police officers. Now, I don't think that in itself is a reason to disbar them, because I do believe that experience in the context of complaint handling, you know, can be, you know, those talents and skills can be tapped into. But that's allowed me quite nicely to lead on to Section 8, because what Section 8 does, and I don't think there is a role for PIRC here, is it removes the responsibility for determination of senior officers' misconduct proceedings from the SPA to an independent panel. So it's completely independent, and I understand that's to be taken forward through secondary legislation. So that is to be welcomed, and that follows on from the Angelini Review's recommendation that the SPA should have no substantive role in senior officer misconduct proceedings. And that makes entire sense, because these senior officers are, you know, they're rubbing shoulders with, you know, the senior management team at the SPA, who are the people who would be responsible for disciplining them if complaints were made against them. But the Angelini Review also recommended a similar independent panel should be constituted for gross misconduct hearings for non-senior ranks. And the bill just does not address that. And the reason why you'll know that the Angelina Review recommended that is, you know, she took the view that all panels, you know, that must be seen to be, you know, having an impartial process. So the legislation falls short in that because it doesn't act on Angelini's reviews in relation to independent panels for all gross misconduct hearings for all ranks. Now, what the government's policy memorandum for the bill says is that the Scottish government's rationale for that decision is, you know, look, this matter of so-called proximity bias doesn't apply to non-senior officers, and it doesn't, except that to the same extent that it does for senior officers. But, you know, the Angelina Review recommendations in this respect did not stem only because of the concerns about proximity bias. And Angelina recommended, look, you know, this recommendation, you know, will have resource implications. And if I can quote what she stated here, she said, however, those costs would relate only to a relatively small number of gross misconduct hearings in any given year and are outweighed by the benefit of increased independence, transparency and public confidence. And that's at paragraph 1261, page 192 of the 2020 report. So again, if we're going back to the objectives of this bill, which, so as far as I understand it, is that there are robust, clear and transparent mechanisms in place for investigating allegations of misconduct against police officers, it doesn't do it. Because when we're talking about Section 8, that's got the exact same limitations as Section 5, in that it applies to a tiny, tiny, tiny amount of police officers, and where we know the vast majority of complaints are in the ranks of ACC and below, in constable ranks mainly.
Thank you very much, Ms. Grimm. Thank you. Okay,
I'll bring in Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Convener. Hello, Margaret.
Hi.
You described the weaponisation of the complaints process against officers, and I think for people that maybe don't know, I think this could be summarised by quite often turning the table on whistleblowers, the inequality of arms that exists in terms of legal representation, the selective application of evidence and the prolonging of proceedings in some cases for year after year after year. And the result of this is careers being needlessly destroyed, health often being harmed and huge financial cost to the victim. I think most of your cases, if not all, are female officers. And I suppose my question is, trying to bring it back to the bill, is do you think the bill can do anything to ensure that Police Scotland no longer uses these weaponisation tactics?
Unfortunately,
Margaret, just before you come back in, I wonder if I can just encourage you to give us slightly more succinct responses. I've still got some members who'd like to come in. Thank you.
Sure, if I could just answer that, please, in the context of Section 13, which it deals specifically with whistleblowing. Now, I'm not really sure what Section 13 is obviously to be fleshed out in secondary legislation, but it introduces, as far as I understand, an obligation on PIRC to keep under review arrangements for the investigation of whistleblowing complaints and to make recommendations. It's quite vague. I don't know exactly what that means. But as I say, that may be fleshed out. But there is also to be some type of audit role for PIRC in relation to whistleblowing. And what the policy memo says there is the idea is that to encourage people to speak up when they see wrongdoing. But the Angelina Review you know, recognise that this PIRC audit function alone wouldn't be sufficient to give whistleblowers confidence in reporting concerns. And I share that view as well. What some of your witnesses spoke about last week was the importance of...
Sorry? Just to come in, Margaret, just to pick up on that point. Therefore, in that section you refer to, it may be worth our while trying to improve that in some way. And rather than secondary legislation, a bit more explicit in terms of what PERT can do in that regard?
Yeah. I mean, in relation to, for example, about the categorisation, because if you're looking at what order and keeping under review, and again, let me give you an example. For this, I represent a detective inspector. She submitted a very detailed witness statement to PSD last year that contained multiple allegations of breaches of the Equality Act. It included criminal allegations against officers as well. It contained, without a doubt, 39 what we call protected disclosures, you know, the legal term for whistleblowing. Now, Police Scotland did not deal with that complaint as a whistleblowing complaint. So how on earth can any external body audit or review so-called whistleblowing complaints if Police Scotland themselves do not categorise whistleblowing complaints as whistleblowing complaints?
So the bill needs to ensure that when a clear whistleblowing complaint is made such as that, it's treated that way by Police Scotland and all associated bodies?
The difficulty from my experience is, you know, I don't think Police Scotland can be trusted to. I mean, this complaint was demonstrably a whistleblowing complaint.
Yeah.
But yeah, like Rona Malone's grievance was demonstrably a grievance. It just, and that's where I think this assessment, you know, if given how important policing is, it's just too important to be left to chance. And I think if that subjected to independent scrutiny, or it's assessed independently, or if I can just say, and what the bill is silent on, is what Dame Angelini recommended is that PERC should be added to the list of prescribed persons in the Public Interest Disclosure Protected Persons Order 2014. That was recommendation 20. Now, I know this is a reserved piece of legislation, but the policy memo, the Scottish Government policy memo, doesn't even address this point at all.
Yeah.
Now, I don't know how difficult or otherwise. Sorry.
Oh, yeah, I was going to ask you about Angelini and PERC. Now, she makes 100-plus recommendations, but she stops short of saying Scotland should be subject to a Northern Ireland-style ombudsman. Now, your trust in Police Scotland, I think, is pretty low. I think that's fair to say on the basis of the cases you've dealt with. But do you think the legislation, as stands, will result in a PERC Mark II, which will be sufficiently credible and have sufficient teeth to protect members of the public and indeed police officers?
No, because I mean, what does keep under review mean? Audit? And again, it's back to the point that I've made. If Police Scotland themselves do not record whistleblowing complaints as whistleblowing complaints, then these complaints have been completely camouflaged. So if PERC say, like, you know, give me data on all your whistleblowing complaints. So if they determine themselves what's to be registered as whistleblowing complaints, then you're not going to have effective scrutiny because they're not being accurately recorded.
Some of the criticism of this bill has been about the financial cost. It's apparently much greater potentially than is in the financial memorandum. Yet Police Scotland must spend significant sums of money in these cases each year and payouts in the nature of your client has received. Is there any consideration as to whether police could, you know, culturally think again about pursuing these costly cases and using that to ensure that systems are improved and complaints processes are improved?
I think the difficulty is the culture and the psyche. It always just seems to be instinctively a defence mechanism. And maybe that's natural. It's it is a criticism, but it's more an observation as well. But, talk about complaint handling procedure. We're not talking about, you know, Scottish Power left me holding for an hour. You know, we're talking about policing here. So it's really, really important. And we're talking at a time where, you know, public confidence in policing is not high. And we're doing this against a background where we've got, you know, the independent reviews I referred to at the outset of my evidence, where we've got cogent evidence to say, look, you know, we've got cause to be concerned here. So given the importance of that. Now, if I can just, in relation to Section 13,
I was just going to say, I think I don't want to hog too much time, but I'll pass back to the convener if that's okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. I know you're clearly immersed in this particular issue, but I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay, and then we will have to conclude our session. So, Rona.
Thanks, convener. Just two brief questions for me. Good morning, Margaret. Just to ask you about the SPA, your of interactions with them, and what do you think their role should be in with all your experience of dealing with the various authorities?
Well, I think in theory, their role is supposed to be to hold the Chief Constable to account, and in my experience, they've not done that, or their oversight is inadequate. And again, give you an example, the Rona Malone case, one of the victimisation complaints that was upheld against her was that Police Scotland victimised her in the handling of her ill health retirement application. And we had recovered documentation from Police Scotland that clearly showed that they were lying to Constable Malone in relation to the reasons for the delay of the IHR. And SPA, which obviously has an oversight function in relation to pensions, they were openly copied into these emails. So this is in theory that the watchdog, but they were being, so there's a culture where we're basically there doesn't appear to be any consequences if you're not following the rules. I think my perception is SPA is too close to Police Scotland. The bill does address that in certain respects, which is Section 5 and 8. It's removing those functions away from them where they previously had the responsibility for misconduct for senior officers. But that's pretty obvious. That should never have been the position from the outset. But in relation to an independent body, I would hope that would not be the SPA.
Thank you. Thanks. That's helpful. Just on that independent body, would you say that ex-police officers and perhaps judiciary should not be part of that independent body? Would you like to see them coming from other walks of life?
No, not necessarily. I mean, I think a lot of it is the culture. I mean, you can't presuppose just because you're an ex-police officer, you come from the judiciary, you've got certain biases. I mean, I think, ex-police officers will have a lot of talent and skill to bring. I think it's the culture in which you're operating. If you are operating in a culture where, and also as well, that the bigger picture is, look, it's good for policing that we deal with these complaints properly, and that's the culture of the organisation. Then I can understand the cynicism and the perceptions of people that it's automatically be police. Defending police, but I think it would really depend on the culture in an organisation, if that culture is to effectively hold Police Scotland to account. I mean, if it's populated, by the majority of ex-police officers, then that would be concerning. But I think there would be a role for them to play in any external body. I know probably some of your witnesses from last week would disagree.
OK, thank you, Margaret. Thanks, convener.
OK, thanks very much. Margaret, that's brought us swiftly round to time. I'm just going to ask a final question, really, and that's just if there's anything else. You've covered quite a lot this morning with particular reference to PERC and some of the provisions that are not in the bill. Is there anything else, particularly about the police complaint system, that hasn't been covered and that you'd just like to touch on before we end our session?
Yeah, just briefly in relation to Section 13, because Dame Angelini recommended that PERC should be added to the list of prescribed persons. The policy memo doesn't even address that at all. Now, I don't know how difficult or otherwise it is to liaise with the Westminster government over reserved issues, but I know the Independent Office for Police Conduct, for example, who carry out similar functions to PERC, is already a prescribed person in terms of that legislation. So that really would, I think, make effective change, because it would give a police officer the statutory right to make their whistleblowing complaints directly to PIRT, even if they haven't made them to Police Scotland. So I think that would be significant. And I think that would do what the bill seeks, which is to encourage people to speak up when they see wrongdoing.
Thank you, Margaret. That's really helpful. So thank you very much for attending today's meeting. I think we've picked up some very valuable points from you, and we're grateful to you for giving up your time. So we'll just have a short suspension just to allow our witnesses to change over. Thank you again.
Thank you. Good morning.
Okay, thank you very much, members. So I'd now like to welcome to our meeting Mr. Ian Clark. Ian, it's very important that we hear the views of those who have personal experience of the police complaints system. The committee is very interested to hear your perspective of what is being proposed in the bill. So I intend to allow around about 45 minutes for this evidence session, and I thought it might be helpful if I open up with a general question about the police complaint system. And I'm aware that you do have a response that you'd like to share with us. So if I can just ask you what you think should be changed about the police complaint system based on your own experience, and just take your time in your response.
Well, thank you very much. The majority of police officers serving and ex could sit here and relate examples of how they or colleagues have been unfairly treated during the misconduct proceedings. 10 years ago last week, I was supposedly committed the crime of assault by preventing a suicide attempt. Over those 10 years, my experience of the misconduct process has been mirrored by investigations by Dame Angelini, HMRCS, PERC, the SPA and journalists, who've all evidenced that the standard of investigation into police misconduct is very poor. My experience was that I was found not guilty after a three-day trial when the sheriff ruled that there was no mens rea and there was a lack of credible evidence. The expert witness used by cops changed his mind and supported my defence when evidence missed out by the investigation was revealed to him. The investigation into me failed to establish much of the evidence was hearsay. It ignored that the medical evidence contradicted the witness claims. I have anecdotal evidence of other police officers whose trials were ended because of a poor standard of investigation. In 2014, the BBC reported on alleged breaches of the Data Protection Act. FOIs revealed that there was often a lack of evidence, and I found that the conviction rate for those reported was only about 7%. The scandal was again the subject of a BBC documentary in 2018, A Force in Crisis, which found that out of 118 reports, there had been two convictions. In 2016, HMICS published a report into the conduct of the Counter-Corruption Unit, and I quote, "A common theme was the legality, proportionality and apparent lack of procedural fairness carried out by the CCU when dealing with police officers and members of police staff." In 2017, I put in a series of Freedom of Information requests and found that from 2013 to 2016, whilst the conviction rate for all crimes was an average of around 86% for the public, it was more like 7% for police officers. PERC used to put information about their rulings on misconduct investigations on X, Twitter, showing they were consistently finding about 50% were unsatisfactory. In 2019, they reported a 44% decrease in the proportion of complaints handled to a decent standard. In 2017, The Sun ran a headline, "Ex-cop on brink of suicide after being fitted up by anti-corruption officers over murder bid case." I know there have been multiple instances of police officers killing themselves whilst being the subject of misconduct inquiries. I spent large periods off sick with situational clinical depression and anxiety, and I was on antidepressants during the last 2 years of my service. Police Scotland are very poor at managing the stress caused by misconduct investigations. It took 122 weeks for my case to go to trial, when the average, according to figures from the SPA, was 54 and a half. It was exactly 900 days from the incident to the day I was found not guilty, ending proceedings by cops. The majority of that delay was due to CAPD, who sat on my report for over a year with no updates and no apparent action. There's plenty of anecdotal evidence from police waiting for years for PSD to conclude their misconduct investigations, separate to any criminal proceedings. That is excessive and causes additional stress, not just to the police, but also their families. And I'd like to take this opportunity to thank my wife, family and friends who supported and stood by me. Not everybody's had that. The SPE stopped publishing figures as to how many police and staff were suspended or on restricted duties in 2016, their last report showing that out of 166 on restricted duties, 27 had been for more than 700 days. In 2018, the Herald reported that nearly 80 police officers had resigned whilst being investigated for misconduct. My experience was that I was able to take early retirement. I could no longer cope with the pressure. Colleagues have provided me with plenty of anecdotal evidence of police found not guilty at trials who were then forced into accepting misconduct sanctions by PSD. My own limited experience of PSD investigations during my service was that they were distrustful, aggressive and assumed guilt. I could not face that. I started by saying that there's a lot of evidence of police being treated badly during the misconduct process. What you'll never get is a police officer to appear and tell you how their misconduct was excused or covered up. In 2018, PERC reported to this committee that they had found evidence of criminal allegations being treated as misconduct. A PSD quarterly report in 2019 recorded that there had been an increase of 161% in the number of police being reported for assault, proving the scale of criminality being hidden. The 2019 Angelini Review of Complaint Handling found instances of the public reporting that their complaints were being excused by the investigating officer. I worked where inspectors dealt with complaints, and the trend was to excuse police considered good officers. Investigations were led by the opinion of the investigating officer had of the person they were investigating. The public also reported that they felt under pressure not to complain or that their complaints dragged out for too long. That was very much my experience when I complained. Complaints were lost, they took months, and they were being passed around between divisions. A chief inspector from my home division visited my home and told me he did not think it was his job to investigate my complaint. A PSD inspector then visited my home and told me that he was the devil's advocate as he sought to excuse the misconduct by witnesses and whoever had conducted the investigation. I met an inspector from the custody division who finally took on the investigation into my complaint. He had retired, so he felt it was safe for him to tell me that he'd been put under pressure from management to dismiss all of my complaints. In the end, most were dismissed or advice given. As Dame Angelini said to this committee when she appeared to answer questions about her review, and I paraphrase, if that's how the police treat each other, what about how they treat the public? The complaint and misconduct process can and does work in many cases, but there is far too much scope for it not to work. It's far too easy to hide and excuse misconduct, and if anything, the greatest risk is not to police guilty of misconduct, it is to innocent police and police who report their colleagues for misconduct. The present system, based on my experience and found by the investigations I've referred to, needs to be changed so it is driven by evidence, not opinion. It needs to be fair and open, with no pressure placed on complainers, no early decisions on who's guilty, believe the victim, or taking sides. It needs to be quicker. It needs to be of a high risk to police who are guilty of misconduct and low risk to the innocent and reporters, so restoring some of the lost confidence in policing in Scotland.
Thank you very much, Ian. We're grateful for that opening statement. Just a couple of points I think would be helpful to clarify. You spoke about COPs, and I take it that you mean Crown Office, just for clarification on that. And also just another point that might be of interest to members is just the process in terms of where there is a trial, a court trial, then it's normally the case that a misconduct process, if there is one to be undertaken, will commence after the outcome of a trial.
They basically both start at the same time. But then when it's decided that this will be reported to CAPD, the misconduct part is paused, and then it will restart again at the end of the criminal proceedings.
I think that's a helpful clarification to provide. I picked up just on some of the final points that you made there, Ian, about a process that is fair, open and based on evidence. And you'll have heard in our earlier session our contribution from our witness, particularly around the independence of the process, and that was subject to members' questions. I wonder if you'd maybe care to comment on your view of the importance of an independent process, whether it is, regardless of what level or what seriousness of misconduct allegation is being dealt with.
Sorry, by independence of the process,
so,
you mean?
So in terms of a misconduct or the police complaint system, we heard earlier about the importance of that process being independent. Do you have a similar view?
It certainly needs to be more independent than it is. I mean, for minor misconduct, you'll find that the sergeant or inspector on the shift will be basically investigating the police officer. So obviously their opinion of that police officer is then going to have a high bearing on what their final decision will be. And I'm quite sure that works its way up through the ranks. For more serious misconduct, I do believe that they tend to draft in, it might be somebody who's a degree separated from the police officer that they're investigating. But still, I mean, I could relate an experience I had where a sergeant phoned me up with regards to an incident to ask me questions about the police officer that was involved, particularly to kind of push their involvement to one side as much as possible. And then obviously when it goes a step further, you've got the Crown Office and CAPD. They have another layer of oversight, and then obviously again PERC on top of that. And I think the further away the investigator is from the person they're investigating, the better.
Thank you for that. I'm sure we'll come back to that. Okay, I'm going to open up questions to members, and I'm going to bring in John Swinney.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Mr. Clark. Just one point, a technical point. CAPD, could you just explain what that is?
It's basically it's the department within the Crown Office that deal with criminal complaints against the police. I don't think it quite stands for criminal complaints against the police department, but yeah. That's kind of what it is.
Yeah. Thanks for that. I recall that reference now. Thank you. Mr. Clark, you bring a very different perspective to the discussion than we've heard from other witnesses so far, and it's a really important perspective that you're bringing to us. But what your perspective sort of illustrates is that the system basically doesn't seem to be satisfactory from anyone's perspective. Would that be a fair reflection of the evidence you've given us within the context of the other evidence that we have heard?
Yes, I agree. The system as it stands is very satisfactory for a police officer who is guilty of misconduct, even criminal misconduct, but can feel rest assured that that misconduct is going to be excused or covered up. There's far too much opportunity for that. In relation to the public and honest police officers, the system doesn't really work at all.
That is a very significant statement you've just put on the record, which I think sharply focuses your evidence. So thank you for that. Would it in the bill there is a provision in the bill to apply the duty of candour in the actions of police officers, but it strikes me listening to you that we need to consider carefully the obligations that we say to the government should be in this bill to be applied to the process of complaint handling within the police service. Because what you have recounted to us in your powerful opening statement is the fact that some of the things that we would all consider to be absolutely essential, fundamentally, truth and integrity, are not always present in the system as you have experienced it as a serving police officer.
Yes, I would agree with that. And as I say, it's not just me. I mean, I still occasionally bump into former colleagues. And when I tell them about this and what's been happening, they then embark on their own horror stories. So, yes.
And from the perspective of you know, if a complaint is made against a police officer, there will be a desire on the part of that police officer to have the matter resolved openly, properly and timeously. But in your experience, that has not been the case.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Clark. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll bring in Russell Finlay, then Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Convener. I mean, so far, your evidence is really clear and compelling, but I suppose what some people might wonder is the incident that started all this is, what, a decade ago now, and you're motivated sufficiently to come to a Criminal Justice Committee in the Parliament to talk about police complaints legislation. Can you explain how this has affected you and why that is so important for you to come here today?
Well, I mean, it terminated my career. I mean, it's kind of luck on my part that I had long enough service, and despite the pension changes, I was able to take early retirement on a full pension. But I mean, I lost a huge lump sum. So it had a huge financial effect. It's had an enormous emotional effect, not just on myself, but on my family as well. I would go as far to say as I don't trust the police, but it's not just that. I don't trust the Crown Office. I don't trust PIRC. I don't trust any part of the system whatsoever, because all of it let me down. I didn't commit a crime. There's no rationality as to why I should have been put on trial. I was subject to 3 days intense scrutiny where they examined every word I said, every slight movement I made for stopping a death in custody. That level of scrutiny rarely, if ever, gets applied to when there has been a death in custody. So, yes, shattered, I think, would be a good word.
And that brings me on to my next question. You've already referenced CAPD, which stands for Criminal Allegations Against the Police Division of Crown Office. It's been in existence since 2013. Hundreds of cases go there. Very few result in prosecutions. Now, some of the previous witnesses have described PIRC, CAPD and all these other entities as almost like a firewall around the police rather than entities that will support officers or the public in terms of complaints. One particular witness last week made criminal allegations about police officers to the police, which should have then been reported to CAPD but were not. Do you think the bill should include a provision whereby either police officers or members of the public can report directly to CAPD to ensure that that potential gap is plugged?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. And the other issue you touched upon was the very sensitive issue of officers dying by suicide. Now, the committee has spoken about this in the past. There have been cases of suicide of officers who were at the time subject to prolonged complaints proceedings. To my extreme concern, when we raised this initially, the Scottish Police Authority asked Police Scotland, who responded to them saying that none of these cases were due to work-related issues. They weren't wholly candid, in my opinion. And I wonder again, looking at it from a legislative perspective, whether anything could be done where there has been the suicide of an officer, that there is some form of automatic fatal accident inquiry provision, as you see with deaths in custody. Every prisoner who dies in custody is subject to an automatic fatal accident inquiry. None of the police officers that we know have died from suicide, and some of whom are subject to ongoing complaints proceedings that they deemed unfair and prolonged, were subject to a fatal accident inquiry. Should the bill also address that potentially?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
That's my very simple answer to that. Absolutely, no. Yes.
Is there anything else in that respect? Or?
No.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Pauline McNeill, then Rona Mackay.
Thank you. Good morning. I listened carefully to what Margaret Gribben said in the previous witness, and what I picked up from what she said is that the bill before us is quite inadequate, and I'm trying to work out for myself, based on, I think, your very important case and evidence, what's the heart of the problem that we need to fix. So that's where I'm coming from. So as you said in answer to John Swinney and Russell Findlay, I mean, it seems extraordinary that someone like yourself, who tried to do a good thing,
by preventing a suicide has ended up in court. So that's the first thing. But I did read about your testimony, but also I read about it in the press. So it's quite clear that when it got to court, the sheriff said there was no credible evidence against you. Now, I've read a few cases that similarly, it's down to the credibility of the witnesses and the evidence. And some of those witnesses have been police officers themselves, I presume. So I was trying to understand, Ian, what... So before I get to my questions about Cap D, which concerned me, because you would think that even if there was, let's say, corruption within the police about an allegation, you would think that Cap D, where it's the Crown Office's responsibility to determine the quality of evidence, that's where a case like yours might have. So, well, there's no case to answer here. So I just wonder if you could just talk me through what happened. I mean, who were the accusers, and how does it get from that point then to a police report in the first place? Because you're a police officer. So it's clear that where there's a crime committed, it's reported, and there's a police report and it goes to the fiscal. Just trying to understand that. That's okay.
I myself never really investigated any complaints. They were always a rank higher whenever I worked. But as I said earlier, the opinion of the investigating officer have of the person investigating does seem to play quite a large part. The two PCSOs who reported me to somebody who I did not get on with at all, who then reported to somebody else, an inspector, who I did not get on with at all. And what appears to have happened is they just took the word of these two PCSOs. They didn't question it. They didn't check it against any other evidence. You know, as I said before, their claims were contradicted by the medical evidence, and they just started the ball rolling. And one of the problems in the job is once the ball's rolling, you're stuffed. Nobody really wants to stop it, because what they're basically saying is they need to be very brave, because they need to come forward and say, right, Police Scotland or Cap D have got it wrong. That officer's actually done nothing wrong. But then they're running into conflict with police management, with Cap D. They're saying the organisation's wrong. It's a lot easier to just let the ball roll and just the officers, the person being complained about, the police officer, is just isolated. It's far easier to pick one side than it is the other. So once that ball had started rolling with me, there was no stopping it. But I would say I was extremely disappointed in Cap D that they just took the witness evidence without ever questioning it. However, I was told by a local solicitor because initially I had no idea what it was I'd done wrong. I was marched out of the custody suite by an inspector who said, I don't know what this is about. I then went home, and a couple of days later I went in to see a superintendent who said, I have no idea what this is about, but I have been told you're a danger to the public and you're now going to be put on restricted duties. So I'm obviously sitting there thinking, what have I done? And it was a number of months later, I finally got a notification that I was going to be subject to misconduct. And in the part where it said what it would actually be about, it just said assault, one word. I said, well, I didn't assault anybody. So again, I've no idea what this is about. But it then goes to Cap D. And at the time I went to see a solicitor when I got that notification and said to him, so what's going to happen here? And he basically said, well, one thing that's going to happen is, what are your plans for the next couple of years? Because there's one person working in Cap D for the whole of Scotland. So the backlog is enormous. So I suspect that's one of the reasons why there was very little scrutiny. They quickly read through the evidence and went, that looks like it's an assault. Let's just put it to trial. And then when it actually went to trial and my defence solicitor spoke to the fiscal who was going to run the trial, the fiscal actually said to him that he felt very sympathetic towards me. He wouldn't be inclined to try and prosecute, but he'd been ordered to.
I find that really helpful, actually, to sort of understand, because it does beg question. And I'm trying to relate what you're saying to the bill. How does the bill help? Because you explained that really well, that once it's kicked off, it's almost like reaffirmation to get to the top. So that just seemed cultural. So you would think then at least there was another body independent from the police that would say, hold on a minute, let's get through this. And that didn't happen. Well, we can maybe check what the resource arrangements are for CAPD. Do you happen to know if it's a, is it a central unit or is it regional? Do you happen to know that? We can find that out.
I think it's central. I remember the solicitor at that time. We are going back to, what was it, 2016, saying that when Scotland had lots of police forces, there was one for each force. But then when they centralised, they just ended up with one. So, yeah.
So what you've said is very helpful about your misconduct complaint and your and all of that about your retirement. So I'm quite clear about all of that, the timescales, the delays. That's kind of easy to work out what you think's wrong there. So that's really, really helpful. But is there anything in the bill that you think other than that would have helped your situation or anything missing from the bill that would make the difference to have stopped that ball rolling before it got to 2 years, 3 years on into...
I think what's in the bill with regards to the duty of candour, especially because I think the bill's angling the duty of candour at the police officer who's being investigated about, I'd like it to be made very clear it's also the police officers who are doing the investigations. It also applies to them, and I think the bill needs to make that really clear. I also think it really does need to be accompanied by sanctions with a failure to do that. And I think the one thing that the bill is missing... And would it be? I'm not sure about what questions I'm exactly going to be asked, but I did read or put an answer which I think is actually quite relevant to what you've said. Yeah. And it's to do with should we be required to produce a code of ethics and introduce a duty of candour? My answer to that was yes, and to include consequences, disciplinary, criminal, or both, for the failure to comply. Codes and duties that are not backed by sanctions, if ignored or broken, are voluntary and can have very serious consequences, not just relating to misconduct, but for all investigations. It's hard to prove a lie. A duty of candour is a lower bar, and it should be easier to prove dishonesty. The code and duty should not just apply to police under investigation, but as I said, I think it should also apply to cops and PERC, the people doing the investigations. There's widespread mistrust within the police of the present misconduct system and the behaviour of PSD, PERC and CAPD. Standards of investigation, as I already said, are poor. Now, to go back to a previous piece of legislation, incidentally by Dame Angelini, in 2010, Section 164 of the Criminal Justice and Licensing Scotland Act introduced a code of practice regarding the disclosure of evidence, including exculpatory evidence, requirement to investigate all reasonable lines of inquiry and to train reviewing officers to ensure that happens. It's not backed by any sanctions for breaking that code. My experience of the investigations, the allegation against me was that reasonable lines of inquiry were not followed, exculpatory evidence was not disclosed, and my case not subject to any review, that the code had been breached and that the code had been breached on multiple occasions. My complaints to Police Scotland, COPS and PERC were all about that. But with the code being voluntary, it was easy to excuse those breaches. And I think how the police and in criminal cases, how CAPD investigate complaints for which the Section 164 Code of Practice is relevant, it should, something like that should be included in the bill. It sets a standard to make investigations evidence-led, fair, thorough and less able to be influenced by opinion. It could be applied to both criminal and the non-criminal parts of the complaint system. The bill that you're proposing states constables act with candour and are open and truthful in their dealings without favour to their interests or the interests of the police service. That's best achieved by evidence-led investigations as set out in that code of practice, which means that scrutiny of standards is also codified. To give a very practical example, we had what was called the vandalism toolkit, and there was another toolkit to do with domestic violence. And it basically said, if vandalism or domestic violence is reported to you, you must do A, B, C, D. You must investigate these individual things, and you are not allowed to conclude the investigation until that has been done. Margaret Curran talked about a lot of, you just can't trust the police. You can't. But if... there is a set procedure that they have to follow and if they don't follow it, they will be punished, then I think you go a long way to driving up standards. Because I'm sorry, all the evidence that I spoke about at the beginning shows a constant, they get reviewed, they're shown that they're not working to a very good standard, and nothing changes. Another few years later, there's another review, there's another investigation, nothing's changed. And I think the only way to do change is to force the change.
Thank you. I don't have any further questions except to just come back to you and say, well, it's clear from what you're saying that duties of candour and honesty need to be applied to everyone, including witnesses, all police officers involved in any investigation. How you do that, I suppose, is because you presumably when they go to court they take the oath anyway, which is meant to be, you know, perjury if you come to tell lies to court, but that's more difficult law. But no, that's really helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Rona Mackay and then Sharon Dewey.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ian. Thanks very much for your evidence. It's really helpful to the committee. I wanted to ask you about non-disclosure agreements in misconduct cases. Were you subject to one of those at any point?
No, I wasn't. Oh, I knew I'd do this. I've lost.
Do you know if they're widely used or?
I don't. I did have. Got it. The thing that I was told about potential questions that I could be asked, and so I do look these things up. I don't see how non-disclosure agreements are compatible with the duty of candour when the duty is to be open and truthful in dealings, and that non-disclosures are the opposite of that. And I found in March 2023, the SPA reported on the use of non-disclosure agreements, stating that there was no attempt to prevent whistleblowing or to hide misconduct. However, in 2021, there was a freedom of information about what non-disclosures were actually being used for. And it included one relating to whistleblowing, one about sexual harassment, one about pregnancy, and the majority were for sex, age or disability discrimination, all of which are indicative of misconduct. I mean, sexual harassment, and they say that they're not covering up misconduct. I just don't see that. Because I retired and there was no sort of, I did think about trying to pursue a case against Police Scotland, and I did go to a solicitor who initially said that no win, no fee. But after one exchange of letters with Police Scotland, the solicitor came back to me and said he wanted £16,000 as a down payment and to expect it to double beyond that. And that was actually the point where I went, no, stop, I've had enough of this, I can't cope.
So NDAs are currently not addressed in the bill, and I think it's something we should maybe find out more about, how widely used they are, and probably should be addressed in the bill, I would suspect.
Because I think I'm safe enough mentioning Rona Malone and Fiona Harper, that they were junior officers complaining about senior officers. And again, when you looked at that 2021 Freedom of Information request, again, it's very indicative of these are complaints against senior police and members of police staff. That's when they're using non-disclosure.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener. Thank you.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you. Just to go back on something you said earlier on, when you were put under investigation, did you say that you'd spoken to a senior officer and he'd said that you were in restricted duties because you're a danger to the public, but at that point you didn't know what it was you had done?
Yes.
Right, so there's an issue with the police, like misconduct disciplinary procedures then, that you were basically put in restricted. Nobody spoke to you about that right at the beginning of the case to take a statement or ask you more details about what happened?
No, again, the solicitor who I went to speak to was the one who told me that there was only one person dealing with all criminal complaints with the whole of Scotland. He also said that if I am interviewed, that he would be present and that I should actually give a statement. But he said, in my case, he thinks it's highly unlikely that I will be interviewed because they kind of play hard and loose with human rights, because you only need to be told what you've been, the accusation is, if you've been charged. So if they don't charge, if they don't interview you, then they don't actually need to tell you what the complaint against you is. So I went 9 months before I actually found out what the assault allegation was, when I was charged by a detective chief inspector who basically told me, I don't see how this is an assault. But of course, under the culture, there's no way he's then going to turn around and say, listen, I'm not charging that police officer. This is nonsense. Get rid of this. He just has to keep up. The ball's already rolling, so he has to keep on going with it.
So is there anything in the bill that we're putting forward just now that would have helped your case at that time? Does it address the fact that you've been put in restricted duties and told you're a danger to the public? And I take it you've seen this solicitor before you've actually been told by your employer what the problem was?
Yes, yes.
So does the bill address that?
Actually, no, I don't think it does, no. No, I mean, I suppose that would be a point. The police should... I mean, really, the person, the inspector... I arrived at work 11 o'clock at night, walked into the custody suite and was greeted by an inspector who I've never met before in my life, who really... It was really embarrassing in front of all of my colleagues. I then get marched straight back out again. As she's saying to me, I have no idea what this is about. I think from that moment, she should have had a very good idea of what this is about, and I should have been told. And yes, actually, maybe the bill should address that. Because keeping police officers in the dark is a feature that I've heard from anecdotal evidence from others and the length of time it takes. And of course, I mean, I mentioned before about the counter-corruption unit and data protection. When I was going through my period, that was at the height of that happening. So I knew I just had to stay there, not ask anybody, not look up any system at all, because they'd be watching me like a hawk as I finally crack and try and find out what's actually going on and why am I on restricted duties. So yes, a provision in the bill to stop that from happening would, I think, help.
That quite hard to believe. I don't know whether that would be a provision in the bill or whether the committee's actually cited in what the police procedures are, or if we can be cited on it.
Yeah.
Because that just sounds a bit bizarre that you can go, is it 9 months, without actually knowing why you're in restricted duties.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So,
I mean, it would be very much an operational issue, but yeah. We can maybe consider if we can get a wee bit more background information on the context of restricted duties. When they're utilised, what they're utilised for and so on. So, yeah, we can come back to that.
It's also straining the police as well if you've got people in restricted duties, which means they're not doing their full job. Mm. When you were with Police Scotland, there's a sense of officers resigning as a way to avoid scrutiny as part of the misconduct process, or are people resigning because of the stress that they're under while being investigated? Both.
Yes.
Right.
I've got it from my experience, general anecdotes, having seen things happen to colleagues. The answer is both. The present system, the bad apples can quite easily escape, and it drives out the good apples because of the inadequacies of the way they investigate. As I said, with the evidence of the incredibly poor conviction rate.
Conduct as well. Do you agree that the misconduct procedure should be able to commence and continue against former officers for allegations that, if proved, would amount to gross misconduct, or should it only be in terms of gross misconduct?
I think, yeah, I mean, if somebody retires or resigned and the allegation against them is incivility during an arrest, something minor, I mean, I don't see how it's reasonable for that to continue. I think it should be automatic for all criminal cases maybe the most serious of misconduct cases.
Yeah. And in the same token, how do you feel about the intention to allow proceedings against former officers to commence or continue up to 12 months after an officer has left the force unless specific criteria are met?
Again, I would agree with that. I mean, all parts of the legal process have time periods where I think it's accepted after you've gone past a certain level of time, it's unfair, possibly breaches your human rights to continue.
Okay, thank you.
I wonder if I can just come in with a question, Ian, and I think in your evidence submission, you raised the issue of the Lord Advocate's Code of Practice in relation to disclosure of information not being enforced in relation to criminal allegations that are made against police officers. I just wondered if you could provide the committee with a bit more information on this, a bit more of your thoughts, and what you think might be required to resolve that particular issue.
I just think that Code of Practice is just a very good code of instructing the police, like the vandalism toolkit. This is how investigations should be conducted. I think it's the Criminal Case Review Commission and the Justice Lab at the University of Exeter found the most common causes of miscarriage of justice, which I think a lot of, I would argue what happened to me was a miscarriage of justice, are official misconduct and disclosure failings. And that, from my experience of what happened in my case, and also anecdotally with others, those problems that actually happen within all police investigations seem to be particularly acute when it comes to complaints handling and misconduct investigations.
That's an interesting point. Fulton McGregor, I think you want to come in.
Thanks. Good morning, Ian. Thank you for your evidence so far. I mean, a lot of it seems to me about the initial period. That seems to be absolutely crucial. And we've heard some evidence from yourself today about a truly horrendous situation, which, if it had been dealt with properly in the first place, might never have transpired. We've also heard evidence from other witnesses where things had been almost the opposite. If things had been looked at properly in the first place, it could have been dealt with better. Have you got any ideas, either, you know, what the bill proposes or any other suggestions about how the process can be made better at that very early stage? You know, when complaints are first made. I know you've referred to a lot of it today, just now, but what do you think we as a committee can do in terms of the bill?
I think I'm repeating myself again. I think if all police officers know that there is a set standard that they have to investigate allegations to, and they know that from the opening, then that should drive up from the very beginning. As a custody sergeant, to give you an example, as a custody sergeant, the most common complaint that I received was these handcuffs are too tight. That was investigated by me putting my finger through the inside of the handcuffs and looking for marks around the wrists to establish. And if I couldn't find any, if the handcuffs were not on too tight and there was no marks around the wrist, end of, I'm not taking the complaint. Now, the complaint against me was apparently that, in effect, I'd assaulted this person. But right from the very beginning, within 20 minutes of this happening, maybe even less than that, they were examined by a nurse who found no injury. Mm. So, I mean, it's instantly it should have been kicked off. Well, see what the witness is describing. It doesn't match what actually happened on the witness. And that should have been picked up at the very beginning. And the only thing that I could think would help would be that from the very beginning, the investigation knows, well, if this happens, you then must do that.
Hmm. Yes, it's interesting that you give that example about the handcuffs, because that was actually where I was going with my second question, was about, so if we take it back to all complaints about the police from members of the public, I'm sure we can all imagine, and you'll know in your experience, I think you've cited one there where a proportion of them, possibly a substantial proportion of them, will be either minor or common, like handcuffs, or even malicious, you know, in terms of when somebody's got any interactions with the police, I'm sure there's a complaint to be made. And then you've got a lot of other complaints that are really serious. How do we make sure that there's a system in place that can deal with that and adequately, you know, almost, you know, branch those off quite quickly, so that resources, police resources, aren't used up as well. Do you understand where I'm coming from with that? So in terms of this bill, so the handcuff complaint that you gave there, you know, you probably would want to, that to remain how it's dealt with just now, as you described, but, you know, does it need to come into an earlier system that, that everything's in?
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me an important part of the bill is codifying ethics and duty of candour. And I'm saying I think they should also codify exactly how the investigation is conducted. And I think that because, funnily enough, one of the issues is, because I'm sure a lot of members of the public would probably think this is quite funny. Oh, what happened to me also happened to that police officer. But the fact that it happened to me really explains why it will often happen to the public. So if police officers have more confidence in the system, I think they're going to engage more with it. And if they see a system that they know has been, in effect, codified to be fair, to be thorough, to follow set procedures, that, and avoid this, I think we mentioned earlier about how certain types of complaint are not being dealt with as they properly should be. Margaret Curran referenced that. Again, if things are codified, I think it'd be harder for that to happen.
Yep, that's good.
Okay, thanks very much. Just in your submission, Ian, you obviously, we know that the trial that you were subject of concluded with essentially no case to answer. And so I'm interested in whether or not there's any acknowledgement from Police Scotland of that, any sort of apology, any kind of redress at all, and if what that would mean to people in the situation that you find yourself. Should Police Scotland, you know, at the very least acknowledge that what happened was essentially an injustice?
I do think that the Bill's proposal of the duty of candour would make it harder for Police Scotland to do what they did to me, which is basically excuse what happened, which was clearly wrong. As for, yes, I mean, it would have been nice to have an acknowledgement from Police Scotland. And I do think, I mean, you're probably thinking more to do with police officers retiring or resigning and they're escaping misconduct. But I'm certainly in that group who would have, I would have loved to have gone to a misconduct hearing after I retired to really try and, must have get my head round why they had done to me what they'd done. But there's other consequences as well. But I now work for a local authority. And obviously they wanted a reference off my past employer. And I had to sit there and say, well, you're not going to get one. And then I had to explain why I wasn't going to give a local authority a reference from Police Scotland. But at least I had a couple of very detailed press reports, thanks to the Daily Record, a news report, to explain what had actually happened. And I was actually able to show that and say, well, this is why you're not going to get a reference off my employer. But other police officers might not have that. You know, their misconduct might have been reported in the press, and then nothing. And so they've got that over their heads forever. Especially the ones who do actually. I mean, the thing takes so long. Police officers do often just genuinely retire during the process. So no, there should be a conclusion.
Okay, thank you. I mean, it just seems bizarre that. You had to seek recourse to media coverage of your case. We're just about up to time, Ian. I don't know if there's any final members want to come in. If not, I'm just going to ask if there's anything further that you would like to add that we've maybe not discussed this morning and that you feel the committee should know in terms of your own view of the provisions of the bill.
No, I mean, as you see, I'd written things down and I'm quite confident I've been through and really raised all the points that I wish to raise. So, Great. No, thank you.
OK, listen, thank you very much indeed. We're grateful for you taking the time to come in, picked up a lot of valuable ideas and perspective from you. So thank you again. And we'll just take a short suspension just to allow our witness to leave. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just going to ask you for
Okay, thank you very much, members. Before we go into private session, just to review our evidence from this morning, we've got one more agenda item, which is consideration of the following negative instrument, and that's the Police Pension Scheme Scotland Amendment Regulations of 2024. And I refer members to paper number 4. Before we begin, I wish to declare that I am a retired police officer from Grampian Police and Police Scotland, and so have an interest in pension matters. So can I ask if any members have any questions on the instrument, or are we content with it? Content? Okay, thank you very much. So that completes our deliberation of the SSI and concludes our public part of the meeting for today. And we'll now move into private session. Thank you.